Hello to everybody and welcome to this webinar about supporting electrification in vehicle development through VIA-grade simulation tools. After being a trending topic in the automotive industry for the last few years, electrification is now playing a solid role in the vehicle design process. New types of components like electric motors and batteries are appearing in a relevant portion of new vehicles. My name is Francesco Ambrogi, and I'm Service Manager at VIA-grade. In today's webinar, we will see how simulation through VIA-grade tools enables users to include electric components in virtual and physical prototyping steps of vehicle design, allowing an efficient assessment of system and overall vehicle performance characteristic evaluation, supporting engineers and other stakeholders in accelerating the vehicle development process. Before diving into the topic, let's have an overview of the types of electric vehicles available today. First type we consider are hybrid vehicles. A hybrid vehicle uses two or more distinct types of power, typically an internal combustion engine and an electric motor. A variant of hybrid vehicles is represented by plug-in hybrid electric vehicles. In this case, batteries are used to power an electric motor, while conventional fuel is powering an internal combustion engine. Battery recharge happens through a wall outlet, a charging equipment, by the internal combustion engine, or by regenerative braking. Last type are the battery electric vehicles. They are using exclusively the energy stored in a battery pack with no other source of propulsion. The new types of vehicles are setting specific trends in automotive industry. EVs are becoming more and more popular because environmental sustainability is a theme of interest for the whole society. Also, for this reason, all the new research and development programs are focused on electrification. There is a market for high-performance vehicles. So many OEMs are now developing electric cars in this segment. Another trend that we see is related to the fact that also in motorsport, we can find a trend into electrification. Since a few years, electric motors appeared in several racing competitions like Formula One. And today we are seeing the focus to be growing even more with competition for fully electric vehicles like Formula E or E-Extreme. Another trend is about the implementation of the so-called rolling platforms. In fact, some suppliers are developing a basic frame of a vehicle without a power unit, an engine or a motor, without a chassis or a body that can be adapted to different vehicle size and layout. Electric vehicles are also posing new challenges into vehicle development. For example, architecture definition in the first phase of the development is critical to identifying the optimal choices in the configuration of the vehicle, and it will influence all the following stages. Chassis design is posing requirements that are different from conventional ICE vehicles. In fact, the electric vehicle has a completely different distribution of weights and subsystems that are influencing the vehicle layout. Range is another critical aspect of electric vehicles because, as of today, it is not fully comparable to traditional vehicle ones, and it may affect the usability in specific conditions. Also, some components are becoming more critical than in the past. If we think about batteries, for example, they are fundamental for both functional and safety issues. So the focus on the development of this new component is becoming a real challenge for the automotive industry. Also in the NVH, the new focus is given to different noise sources. For example, in the past, the main noise source was related to the engine. And now, given to the electric motors being more silent, the focus is moving into the tires. Also, packaging is totally different to traditional vehicle. And finally, the thermal management is an aspect that is related to efficiency and performance that must be definitely addressed. All these challenges can be addressed only by increasing the usage of integrated simulation techniques. And in fact, Via Grade is proposing an approach in which offline simulations are connected with the driving simulator and other in-the-loop activities. This approach is allowing the CAE engineers and test drivers to work together to speed up the development and the innovation in the automotive process. Now, going more in detail into Via Grade's vision, we can divide the development process into three phases. First phase is related to offline simulation. It is condensed basically in the first part of the vehicle development, and it helps to solve the crucial aspects of the project, from target settings to typical suspension KNC analysis, down to vehicle dynamics and control design. In a second phase, driving simulator can analyze and address ride, handling, NVH, and special missions related issues. Finally, hardware in the loop can focus on the aspects that are requiring an extensive component or subsystem physical testing, like motors or batteries. So, for what regards the offline, the engineers in this phase are setting targets and performing preliminary analysis to estimate the vehicle performance. In the early phases of the development process, most of the simulation are therefore performed offline, in some cases relying on carryover data from previous projects. For the application of electric vehicles, offline simulation is fundamental to explore the available options and to identify the optimal solutions. In a subsequent stage, we can move into the usage of driving simulator. Driving simulators are bridging the gap between testing and simulation. In fact, CAE engineers and test drivers can work together on the same platform, the driving simulator, and the feedback coming from the test drivers, even being subjective, can improve the vehicle model faster and easier. So also the subjective feeling, which is fundamental to advance the development, can be easily seen as experimental data on the driving simulator. Finally, we can move into a phase where the real-time hardware and prototypes are becoming available. In this case, real-time models are still fundamental for hardware in the loop analysis and testing. In this case, we are trying to connect together physical components like motor, batteries, and controllers, interacting with the virtual vehicle model that is running on a hard real-time computer. So in this case, hardware in the loop testing can bridge the gap between virtual and physical prototyping. Let's now have a look into how the typical electric vehicle components are represented and made available in VA Grade technology. We'll be talking mainly about, at least in this part, about VIECAR Real Time, which is the vehicle simulation platform that has been implemented and provided by VIA Grade. First of all, let's focus on the architecture, possible architecture configurations that are available in car real time for what regards the driveline. In this environment, it is possible to support front, rear, and all-wheel drive types of driveline with several combination of internal combustion engine, motors, and other typical driveline components like clutch, gearbox, differentials, and for the electric vehicle, batteries. The environment is basically available through a UI in which the user can select the type of layout that want to be implemented. So for example, we can start for a traditional layout with gearbox and clutch, and then we can complement it with the addition of electric motors, for example, on the front axle, or with a single motors with the usage of a front differential. Or if we want to move to a fully electric architecture, we can simply select the no differential layout and activate the front wheels motors with the battery or the four corners motors configuration. And finally, we could also have a case in which we may want to consider just two motor configuration with all-wheel drive. This is something that is easily interchangeable in the simulation environment provided by VIACAR real time. If we talk about electric motors, we can state that VIACAR real time can support different modeling options, starting from the so-called simple motor, where the model characteristics are provided basically by input of maximum and minimum torque and maximum power, down to standard motor, where we implement the torque characteristics as a function of RPM and throttle demand, or for electric motors in which we can provide separate maps for driving, braking, coasting condition, and also including the possibility of providing a regenerative braking algorithm with a specific lookup table. For the batteries, VIACAR real-time is supporting an internal model in which it is possible to select the type of battery that needs to be implemented, and then to input specific parameters like voltage, capacity, state of charge, and peak current that can be used then during the simulation. Finally, talking about control system for the driveline, we can say that VIACAR real-time is supporting specific embedded controllers for the basic tasks like idle control or maximum RPM control or traction control, which is separate for each instance of electric motor present in the vehicle. And for more specific type of controller, like energy management, torque management, and battery management systems, it is possible to integrate and extend the model through external implementation of mathematical models. For example, the interface with MATLAB Simulink is providing the capability of accessing any subsystem or control system in the vehicle. We have some distribution example that are coming with the VIACAR real-time installation. So going a little bit in more detail into the offline phase, let's try to analyze some of the typical tasks that are addressed using this this phase of the vehicle development process. Questions that must be addressed are related to the general vehicle configuration. So vehicle weight, which is the range, the type of architecture, motor configuration, and weight distribution. These are all information and data that can be analyzed quite quickly, as we will see later in a small example. Then we can move into the typical ride and handling analysis phase, in which we can focus on suspension design and the full vehicle dynamic assessment, including the usage of open loop and closed loop events, in this case with the support of a virtual driver model. Then we can extend the model using specific implementation for the driveline and controllers. In this case, we can complement the model with external components and implement more complex subsystems that are taking care of the regenerative braking, of the driveline thermal management, of the torque vectoring or active suspensions. And finally, we can also focus on the specific NVH related tasks. In this case, we can analyze the noise and vibration that are coming from the different sources within the model. So let's try to see all these aspects a little bit analyzed in a small live example. We consider a live demo now about modeling, implementing design study, in general sense to assess the vehicle performance. So we move into the VIACAR real-time simulation environment, and basically we start creating a new vehicle. Imagine that we want to implement a new electric vehicle, and we need to start completely from scratch with a new project. What we can do in Vehicle Real Time is to take advantage of the so-called Vehicle Wizard. The Vehicle Wizard is a UI in which it is possible to implement a vehicle model with a few parameters that can be then modified and refined in a later stage of the process. So, as you can see here, for example, we can define the vehicle mass and weight distribution characteristics, some general properties for the aerodynamics, identify the properties of the suspension and the tires, and finally set input for the powertrain and brakes subsystem characteristics. So I have created an example configuration that I want to use. So imagine that we want to create a sport car type of vehicle in which we want to select specific mass properties. So in this case, I'm setting 1,360 kilograms, considering that I will add later on the battery. And for example, I can select also the topology for the suspension, taking a double wishbone for front and rear suspension. So when I'm done with these parameters, I can create the vehicle model. It is taking just a few seconds to prepare all the files that are needed for the different subsystems that will create the vehicle model. And then I will be able to access the vehicle itself within the car real time environment. So the creation is completed. I can close this dialog, and from the build mode in car real time, I can load the model, which is now available and organized into different subsystems. So I have the suspensions and steering, the body, wheels, brakes, and powertrain. Now, for what regards the body, I basically, as I said, I used to input only the mass of the vehicle, not considering the battery, because this will be part of a study that will be performed later on. So I can imagine that I have, beside the body chassis mass, I will introduce some mass represented by fuel to describe the battery and the position on the vehicle. So I just load a property file with the characteristics of the battery already implemented, and in this case I'm seeing that for the body setup I have set 300 kilograms of weight given by, in this case, the fuel, but it will represent the battery. And the position of the battery is basically on the floor of the vehicle, and the center of gravity is more or less at half of the wheelbase. For the powertrain, we have generated a model which is using a typical and conventional internal combustion engine, but of course we want to change into some more, let's say, electric-like, and so we select the configuration with four motors, and we do activate the motor instances on the four corners and the batteries. Also in this case I had prepared the data with all the properties already set. So if we go into this drive line, I can navigate in the different properties, for example selecting the lookup table for the torque characteristics of the motor. And the same is done for the battery. In this case we are representing the electrical properties, so we have a capacity of 150 ampere per hour for this specific battery. And then in the model, of course, I have also possibility of accessing data regarding the typical suspension characteristics, and so you can see here that I'm I can basically visualize the layout of the suspension, and I can also modify the properties, for example, the geometric location of the R points is something that is automatically updated in the model, and I can just play with that and modify and to analyze the configuration. So in this stage, I have basically completed the definition of my vehicle model. So what I could do is just to go in the so-called VECAR real-time test mode and create a mission, which could be, for example, to perform a simulation in which I try to achieve the maximum performance on a specific track. I define a trajectory, which is the driver target that I want to follow, and the environment will compute the vehicle longitudinal velocity profile that is feasible for the specific vehicle that I have implemented. I can start the simulation. In this case, we will see that the model, before being able to run, gets analyzed in terms of suspension characteristics. This is because the vehicle model is needed to be run in real time, and to be as much efficient, we can extract from the suspension mechanical properties like location of the R points and components characteristics, a set of lookup tables that are representing the model and that can be that are suitable to run in real time. So right after this preparation phase, we can basically preview the simulation progress while it is executed. In fact, you see that a new window is now popping up, and it is loading the configuration of the vehicle, which is running along the track. You can see that the vehicle is following the trajectory, and in some steps the simulation is stopping and going back because the target that the vehicle is trying to follow is not visible, and so the algorithm needs to be modifying the target velocity profile in order to make it completely feasible and successful. So I have finished the simulation, and I can of course access the states of the vehicle and review the results that have been achieved. So this is let's say first step. Now what could be interesting, given an initial configuration of the vehicle, would be to analyze how some design changes will affect the performance of my vehicle. And to do that, in VECAR real time, we can take advantage of the so-called investigation mode. In investigation mode, we can implement design studies and design of experiments to analyze the KPI variability depending on specific model parameters. So to do that, basically we do create a new investigation, and for example I could use the event that I just ran to implement this study. In the study we need to define which are the factors, so the design variable that we wanted to analyze, compared to the responses, so the objective that we want to achieve. So for example, in this case, what we could do is to first of all analyze the effect of defining a different battery pack for my vehicle. If you remember, we have set up the characteristics, the mechanical characteristics of the battery, so let's say center of gravity, location and mass, through the fuel setup. We use the fuel to represent the mass of the battery. So what we can do, we can basically apply the setup and running mass as study factors, as well as the location of the center of gravity of the battery. In a specific case, let's say we want to compare a configuration in which we move from the original location of the battery pack, was expected to be on the floor in the middle of the wheelbase, with another configuration in which we move the battery pack backwards and in a higher position with respect to the vehicle floor. And we can also consider as additional, let's say, parameter to identify if we want to study the effect of having a more capable battery in a vehicle, of course, considering the effect that it will have on a mass. So for a battery, let's say we take the electric properties in the driveline, and basically we use the capacity as this parameter to analyze the study. And then we may want to complement the study that we want to do with specific suspension characteristics. So to make it easy, for example, we could decide, also considering the difference in weight that we will introduce in the study, analyze the anti-roll bar with a different stiffness value that we can study through a scaling factor for the front and rear suspension anti-roll bar force. And then we can, let's say, group together these characteristics. So, for example, we can expect that the mass is something that is going to be changing together with the capacity of the battery, while the location of the center of gravity of the battery is a parameter that we may want to use separately. So we analyze two options, so one with lower and central battery position, and the other one with more in the rear and higher position. And then we want to use to analyze the performance of the vehicle, some metrics. So, for example, we could add a first response, which could be the lap time of a specific simulation using maximum performance, and to do that, we select the end time of the simulation. So we take the last value of the time in the simulation, and then we can add an additional metric, which could be, let's say, the state of charge of the battery at the end of the analysis, at the end of the lap. In this case, we can take the battery, sorry, the state of charge, and create the metric for the last value. Let's say, if to make more interesting this experiment, we have run that already. And we can consider the lap to be ex to be the vehicle to be exercised on the Nordschleife track, which is the typical benchmark case for sport vehicles that are in this category. And so we want to see how changing these parameters that we have identified will affect the performance of the vehicle. And so basically it is possible to analyze and visualize the design space that has been implemented, and we can see that we have several combination of the different parameters that we have identified. In this study, we also have chosen some additional metrics like the maximum roll angle and lateral acceleration. Now, of course, executing the simulation may take some time, but in general, in a few, let's say, depending on the length of the simulation. In this case, I think it was some simulation to be run on a track which is long about 20 kilometers, so it took a little bit of more than 1 hour, but we can just review the results and load it into this report. What we see here is basically a plot which is comparing the different variant. In this case, we analyzed the 16 variants of the model with a combination of the different parameters. And here on the right part, we can, for example, in these two axes, compare the lap time with the state of charge at the end of the lap. So you can see that in the specific choice that we made, for example, we could pick up, I don't know, this one, which seems to be the quicker, the fastest combination. For example, we see that we have the battery stage, in this case, is the state of charge is going below 50%. But the vehicle seems to be the quicker one. And at the same time, we identify the position of the battery, which is the one closest to the floor, as the more efficient in terms of performance. As a compromise, if we want to have instead accepting a higher lap time, we can see that the velocity, the state of charge of the vehicle may be higher. In this case, we have a different mass, of course, related to the bigger battery pack that we have been choosing. So basically, in this case, we can stay up to 60%, so 10% more than the fastest one, because of the different choice that we have made for this specific vehicle. So as you can see, let's say some questions posed by the initial definition of the vehicle are easily addressable with this simulation. And we can do a further step in complementing the model with more, let's say, complex type of vehicle. So for example, we may want to implement in the Simulink environment a controller which is taking care of the general control of the vehicle, a VCU system. What you see here is the interface that the iCar Real-Time is providing within the MATLAB Simulink environment. In this case, we have a block which is representing the vehicle model, which is exposing a set of input and output that can be connected to a controller, a different mathematical model, and analyzed in co-simulation. So in this case, if we navigate this block, basically we have implemented a torque management system and a battery management system and a battery model, which at the time, the moment are disabled, but that could be potentially used within the model. So what we could do at this point is to analyze in the co-simulation the model, but another interesting aspect that we could address could be also to generate a library that can be used directly in the iCar Real-Time standalone to represent this controller. In order to do that, basically we can just take advantage of a specific co-generation tool in MATLAB Simulink, implementing a target that is providing the output for the iCar Real-Time. In this case, we can simply create the model and compile a corresponding DLL and subsystem file that can be used in the iCar Real-Time. In this case, now the process is still running, and again, we have initialization of the model as we have seen before. And then we are entering into the code generation phase, which is basically creating the library that can be used in the iCar Real-Time. So if we now go back into the simulation environment, we can complement the vehicle model with an auxiliary subsystem that has been generated, which is exactly representing the controller that we have in the MATLAB Simulink environment. So in this case, for example, we have some torque vectoring gain controller that are exposed that can be also directly tuned in the iCar Real-Time. So what we could do now is to go in the test mode and implement a simulation in which the behavior of the vehicle with no controllers, a passive vehicle model, is compared to the behavior obtained by the vehicle model, including the controller. So we run the simulation. In this case, we are not using the live animation feature, so basically we are running the simulation in background. This is still the initialization phase, and then we will see how the simulation is progressing. So you see that here we have some iteration again, as we have seen before for the passive model. And then the simulation is continuing until the end of the track. So simulation is completed, and now we can review the results. For example, comparing the two simulations, the one with the passive model with the one with the controller in it. So you see that we have in this animation two instances. The red vehicle is the passive one, and the blue vehicle is the same vehicle but with controller. So we can, for example, run the animation and analyze and visualize how the two vehicles are performing. So we see that there is some kind of difference and some kind of gap that the controller is introducing, giving basically a better overall performance of the vehicle with respect to the passive one. And so this is a specific case in which we can then analyze all the driver input, the states of the vehicle, the GG diagram, or for example the distribution of torque. Here you see the different configuration between left and right due to the torque vectoring, or simply the state of charge of the battery that we have in the model. So again, specific tasks, specific points related to the definition of the target and definition of the vehicle can be addressed with this tool. And so we can now go back to our presentation, talking a little bit about offline workflow, talking about the MVH. In the case of the MVH, we have mentioned before that for electric vehicles, there are different sources of noise and vibration that are acting when compared to the traditional internal combustion engine vehicles. So, for example, in the other case, we had mainly the engine. Now we will have to focus on different type of models. The point here is that we can create electric motors and driveline models in CAE simulation environment, and these models can be then transformed into transfer function and be able to be used to represent a different complexity of MVH models that can be used to analyze the powertrain sound quality even before that the hardware prototypes are available. So with this let's say MVH implementation, we can, let's say, complete the offline phase. Then we can move into the driver in the loop phase. So driving simulator is something that is becoming the next step. Basically, the model that we have seen so far that has been used for the offline can be seamlessly integrated into a driving simulator. So we have the possibility of using exactly the same platform to simulate with the presence of a real driver how the vehicle is behaving. In this environment, it is possible to implement and integrate external software in the loop models, and eventually also have ADAS systems to be tested online, HMI implemented, and so on. With the driver in the loop, it is possible to perform all the tests that are typically executed in a proving ground, going from or in a, let's say, public road testing. So going from range studies down to highly dynamic events in completely safe conditions, or in all the studies related to subsystem and controller setup can be executed. And of course, we can have in different steps come up to a virtual vehicle assessment, which is including a real traffic environment and the possibility to consider also extreme conditions or fall condition to be analyzed. In this workflow, what is remarkable is that ViaGrid is providing a lineup of driving simulators that can fulfill different tasks and different complexity. So ranging from a desktop simulator into static simulators into fully dynamic and with different size type of simulators. First of all these simulation environments have a common software stack, so the vehicle models can be easily transferred from one simulator to the other. And of course, we can provide a proven motion platform technology that is also ready to be connected with Arduino in the loop system, because it is intrinsically relying on a real-time computing platform that is used for the driving simulator and for the vehicle model. There is a common active technology for what regards seats and belts that are complementing the cues that are coming into the driver, and an open software framework which is possible to connect with different vendors for what regards dynamic models. The environment can be also complemented, as I mentioned before, with specific HMI that is used along the driving simulator session, which are resembling what a physical vehicle is providing. So we can, for example, define different operative modes for the driveline. In this example, we have the eco, normal, and sport configuration. We can set up the layout for the drive line, going from a full all-wheel drive to front or rear-wheel drive, as we have seen in the offline case. And we can also implement and activate specific ADAS, like adaptive cruise control, lane keeping, lane departure warning, and so on. So this environment can also be applicable for the usage in the NVH. So what we have seen before, in a few slides before, for NVH implementation is also available as a driving simulator experience for what regards noise, vibration, and harshness. So in this case, the numerical model can be implemented on an NVH simulator, and basically it will give the possibility of experiencing sound and vibration directly on the simulator, like on a real car, which is very important because typically NVH decisions are taken later in the development process because of the need of putting together a mule or a prototype machine. Prototype vehicle. In this case, we have instead the possibility of testing the sound and the vibration directly on the driving simulator. And finally, we have the last phase related to the hardware in the loop. In this vision, hardware in the loop for electric vehicles is becoming straightforward to be implemented on a driving simulator-centric framework. Basically, this environment is scalable, configurable, and upgradable, and because of its real-time capabilities, so the real-time capabilities of the simulator is ready to be plugged into hardware in the loop system. And so we can apply the driving simulator together with hardware in the loop to several applications that are requiring the usage of real-time mathematical models with specific hardware tests, and it can be applied for simply ACU studies down to very complex test rigs in which we want to analyze and assess battery or fully electric powertrain in principle, together with eventually with the driving simulator. And of course, this is very important and useful for fulfilling operative testing, durability testing, and fault injection, all the tasks that are typically done developing the physical components in this case. Okay, so given this overall vision, would like to mention just a few examples of customers that are already using this technology. The first one is NIO, who is using VIACAR Real Time and the DIM 150 as a multi-level development platform that is used for different tasks. So starting from suspension tuning and down to racing performance and driver experience evaluation for their electric vehicles. So the approach is similar to the traditional the topics taken for traditional vehicles, but in the case of electric vehicles, this is becoming even more important because of the characteristic of the vehicle itself. Also, Benteler is using VIACAR Real Time and DIM 150 mainly to develop a specific electrical drive system. And the achievement in this case was that doing the development in a virtual environment led to meet 80% of the target already with the first prototype. So the advantage is basically a reduction in costs and time related to the fact that there is need for less number of prototypes. Another customer of VA Grade who is using this approach and this technology is Danisi Engineering. In the case of Danisi, the approach is a combination of software, human and hardware in the loop to integrate mainly the electric vehicle suspension design and the controllers related to torque optimization, which is which has provided an improved performance with less development time and of course also a lower cost. Just a mention about Motorsport that we did just at the beginning. So Virgin Racing is Envision Virgin Racing is using the static simulator in the Formula E preparation and training. In this case, the tool is let's say a combination of a training tool for the drivers and a development tool for the engineers. This is the typical case where for example, the preparation of a race can be done completely off the track, and all the let's say mechanisms that are related to setting up a specific Formula E race can be tested by the team even before that the practice sessions are starting. And with a similar approach, also Peugeot Sport is using the static simulator to accelerate the development of the hypercar that they are putting in place for the 2022 Le Mans Hypercar program. And so also in this case we have the advantage of accessing the simulator technology in an early phase of the development of the vehicle. So coming to conclusions, we have seen that the electric vehicle design is a challenging process which is involving different disciplines and requiring mainly to also to rethink the traditional vehicle development process. Using the simulation is providing answer to several of the challenges that are posed by the development of electric vehicle, and basically these tools can really bridge the gap between testing and simulation and address also different disciplines at the same time. The simulation-driven approach also allows to increase the innovation because it makes possible to front-load the issues in the development process and to decrease the development time, leading to a safer product and with the less cost. With that, I'm coming to the end of my presentation. If you are interested, you can request a demo of our technology by sending an email at info@viagrade.com. And with that, I thank you for your attention and we can be opening the Q&A session, and we'll be happy to take your questions.